independent director. Now one of the important changes brought about by
the Companies Act 2013
is the introduction of independent directors, and that is based on the philosophy that there has to be greater transparency,
greater accountability.
There should be greater transparency, greater accountability under the new act,
and there
the independent directors have to play an important role. Okay, it's like that. No problem. Because so long it is there, fine. It's not there, my voice is loud enough to reach the last chair also.
No problem. So, to meet this, you are able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So, keeping it in the new philosophy of the Companies Act, you have greater accountability. There is a greater role to be played by the independent directors, which we will see the kind of expectations which the lawmakers have of independent directors. One of the factors which has influenced this particular feature is the Satyam episode. Although after Enron, the Companies Act has been undergoing a change, corporate governance norms have been undergoing a change, but the immediate provocation, if I may put it that way, was Satyam episode. And as our lawmakers have a tendency, if one fellow is guilty, make life miserable for everyone else. So if you are passing through the customs and two fellows have tried to smuggle, the rest of the passengers to be checked. So the regulator's weakness, they convert that into their strength for themselves, so that everybody else gets punished. And that is something like that they have attempted here. Now, when we come to the board, let me start with the composition. I have not segregated separately mentioning that this is under the company, that this is under clause 49. These are all together, because when you will be complying with, you will not segregate that this is as far as 149 is concerned, this is as far as clause 49 is concerned. Both will have to concurrently go on. So the composition of the board here, optimum combination of executive and non-executive directors. At least one woman director, and this is more important, not less than 50% of the board comprising of non-executive directors. Now here, for the purpose of 50% of the board comprising of non-executive directors, will also include your independent directors as well, because all independent directors are non-executive directors, though all non-executive directors need not be independent directors. Now, so far as woman directors concerned, every listed company has to have a woman director, and every public company having a paid up capital of 100 crore or more, or turnover of 300 crores or more, has to have a woman director. 1 year time has been given to comply with this requirement, although many companies believe in 1 year may be short, having regard to the demand for the number of women directors that will be required vis-a-vis the availability. But be so it may, companies have already started seriously working, because many companies, they believe that it is better to have competent professional women directors, and not merely for namesake to anybody on the board from non-circles. We'll have to wait and see how this experience goes. Small shareholder director, not strictly under the independent category. I just mentioned that companies having 1,000 or more shareholders, listed companies with 1,000 or more shareholders, they may appoint an independent small shareholder director, either so voto on their own, or when shareholders demand, those who are at least 1,000 in number or 10% of the shareholding, whichever is lower, then they have to appoint this, as you may recall, was there in the earlier act also, and this was there because of the demand from consumer associations that small shareholders should have a chance to have their own nominee. And when the 2000 Act was being, 2000 Amendment Act was being brought on, at that time it was in the draft bill was mentioned shall, but when it became Amendment Act, quietly shall became may, and that may continues. So it is for the time being an optional provision, and for some time to come it will not see light of the day. Now we come to the topic of the evening, independent director. The concept of independent director. I thought this particular picture really mirrors, because in my view there is a little confusion in the mind of the government that what is the role of an independent director? Is he some police inspector? Is he a government nominee on the board? Is he supposed to be working for the regulators? Or is he part of the board and working along with the board, along with the other directors? Let's see what is expected of the independent director. Now, first of all, every listed public company has to either one third or half of the total number of directors as independent directors. Now, how do you know or decide whether it should be one third or half? If the chairman of the company is a promoter director or relative of the promoter or executive director, executive chairman, then that board should have at least half comprising of independent directors. But if the chairman is the independent chairman, non-executive, non-related chairman, then in that case, one third of the board should comprise of independent directors. Now, if you have to have more number of independent directors, no issues. But minimum one third in case of it. So, simple way of remembering, if you are independent chairman, one third minimum. If he is a related chairman or executive chairman, then half the board has to be independent directors. What about the other public companies? Other public companies having 10 crore paid-up capital or turnover of 100 crores or more, or now this is a new concept brought in, if they are having aggregate outstanding loans, debentures, deposits exceeding 50 crores. Earlier at PISA, most of the time the criteria used to be in terms of the paid-up capital of the company. Here there is a turnover concept which used to be there in the earlier section which was withdrawn in 2043A. There was a turnover concept. Now even the borrowing concept has been brought in, so that if it is more than 50 crores, even that company should have independent directors. So it must so happen, you have a closely held public company, hardly any public shareholder, maybe even a family may be controlling that, but you have to have independent directors. If either borrowings, loans, debentures or total together exceeds 50 crores or 50 crores or more, then you need to at least two independent directors. So the idea, and this again let me share with you, arises from the recommendation of the Narayanchandra committee, where fortunately I happen to be a part of the committee, and where it was discussed that there should be least regulation for the company which does not take public funds and where it is a family affair. And there it was classified that most of the private companies would fall in that category. Now it is a different issue that under this act, private companies have been virtually treated as if they are public companies. So I recently written an article on that saying whether the intention of 2013 act is to kill private companies. So that either they become LLPs or they wind up, or they convert into public companies full-fledged then. Because today also 90% of the companies as per MCA owned statistics are private limited companies, and 92% of the active companies are private limited companies. And that was the understanding of the Narayanchandra committee, which was accepted by the government, that private companies should have a liberal regime. But here contrary has happened. And it was said that against in public companies, listed companies should have the maximum regulatory regime because they are taking public funds. And so far as unlisted public companies are concerned, The thinking was that promoters are voluntarily opting to go for a public company. Nobody is forcing them. There is a private company, there is a public company, there is a listed company. So listed highest, medium for public, minimum for private. And therefore it was thought that if a public company, even though closely held, goes for public funds via loans, borrowings, deposits, etc., then there should be some extra regulations. And that is why you find the requirement of an independent director, even for a closely held public company, which has borrowings. Every existing company to have independent directors within 1 year from the commencement or from the date of notification of the rules. So in this case, by 31st March, all the companies have to be compliant. Now this is an interesting provision where independent director is not defined. That's why I mentioned, you can say these are the qualities or qualifications, or conversely, disqualifications if one doesn't have or one crosses the threshold, then one may not be eligible to be appointed as an independent director. So subsection 6 of section 149 is one of the very important provisions because it comprehensively covers the requirements or the qualities which a person wanting to become an independent director should have. So an independent director in relation to a company is, this is how positive you appoint a director other than a managing director, whole-time director or a nominee director. Obviously it is understandable. A managing director and whole-time director cannot be an independent director. Earlier, prior to 2013, it was understood that a nominee director is also independent director because he belongs to banks and financial institutions, etc. But then the thinking was that after all, he is also representing a group of shareholders. They have their own interest. So to that extent, he is also an interested director. And therefore, a nominee director cannot be treated as an independent director. Person of integrity. I always believe that all directors are persons of integrity. But perhaps the events have proved that directors are not persons of integrity. So now we have to find a person with integrity so that he can become an independent director. Now, it may seem ironical, but that is the reality of life. Because earlier, as we all would know, being professionals and particularly chartered accountants, that a director is supposed to be a director of the company and not a director of the promoters. Just as the prime minister is the prime minister of the country and not from a particular party, though he may belong to a particular party. So also, but obviously, somewhere down the line, the companies have failed, or many companies have failed, and therefore, today, your first requirement that he should be person of integrity, although I still believe that every member of the board has to be a person of integrity without doubt. Possess relevant expertise and experience. Now that is left to the company to decide what is that relevant expertise and experience. Because the whole purpose of having independent directors is not to merely fill the board with designated persons who are called independent directors. Idea is to have people from different walks of life with different specialties who will be more relevant to the company. Now for example, if you take a real estate company, people who have exposure to real estate, to development, the government regulations dealing with development, etc., they would be more useful then some chemical engineer sitting on the board comparatively. That's why the relevant expertise and experience, not a promoter of the company. Now this particular phrase you'll find again and again, not a promoter of the company, it's holding company, subsidiary company, associate company. In nutshell, what we generally loosely call as a group. So if he is connected with any of these group companies or he is a promoter, then he is not eligible to be an independent director. Now this you will find an interesting one. He has no, neither he had in the past nor any current pecuniary relationship with the company, its holding company, subsidiary company, associate company or their promoters all directors during the two immediately preceding financial years or during the current financial year. Current year plus two preceding years, no pecuniary relationship whatsoever, because there are no limits prescribed here. And with the entire group, their promoters and all the directors. The whole object being that identify people who are in no way connected with the company or the group. Now here the issue arose, what if even one rupee transaction is done? Literally it means yes, because that is a pecuniary relationship. Now the government has clarified that if it is done in ordinary course of business and at arm's length transaction, then that will not be covered under this particular clause. And even though the particular person or professional, because particularly a lot of professionals fall in this category, so if that is at arm's length, which itself is a separate concept which you people are very well versed better than me, so if that is so, then even though pecuniary relationship was there or is there, it will not be hit by this sub clause. Now we come to a wider terrain. Independent director is fine. That person who wants to become independent, none of whose relatives has or had pecuniary relationship or transaction with the company, its holding company, subsidiary company, associate company, or their promoters, their directors, amounting to 2% or more of the gross turnover, or total income of 50 lakhs or more, as may be prescribed, whichever is lower during the two immediately preceding financial years. Now here there are two parts, as we can see. One is the relative. Fortunately now the definition of relative has been curtailed, unlike the earlier definition in the 1956 Act. But still, today, how many persons know what their brothers are doing? My brother wouldn't know exactly what I am doing. And I may not know what company is, what he is doing. The way here it is expected, and then the turnover limits. If you are dealing with a large company, perhaps 50 lakhs may not be a big deal at all. So, again the thrust is that only, that if there is some interest which could hamper in the thinking or working of that person and have an impact or adverse impact on the independence, should not be permitted. And it is in that direction that, as you can see, all the group companies, all the promoters, all the directors, and none of the relatives should be having dealings with any of these persons for 3-year period, that is current plus the previous two. Then again, either he himself or any of his relatives should not be holding any key managerial position, or should not have held in the past any key managerial position, again either in the company or any of the group companies qualified as a subsidiary or a holding or associate company in any of the three preceding financial years. And key managerial personnel, when you go by the definition, you know, the managing director, CEO, manager, whole-time director, CFO, company secretary. None of these should have been there if he is related to these people or he has been holding this position. Then obviously again he is not qualified to be independent director. See, these are again why government has done this. These are also arising out of practical experience. One leading group, obviously I will not name it, I came across a few years back, their CEO of main company had retired and he was shown as an independent director in rest of the other group companies. And that's why this has arisen from that either that person himself or his relative If he has been holding that position, responsible position as one of the KMPs, shall not be eligible. Now this is going to affect the professionals. Although some concession is there in the second category, so far as auditors are concerned, there is a 3-year cooling period. If somebody has been a partner in the auditor firm or cost accountant or company secretary firm or a proprietor, then there has to be a 3-year cooling period before that person can qualify to become an independent director of that particular company with which he or she was connected. Of course, the idea behind is very clear, that having held that kind of position, there is every possibility that one may not be able to be independent to the extent expected. Whereas with a cooling period of 3 years, it is believed, although these are all debatable issues, because in the beginning when this concept of independent director started, the argument used to be, how do you define independence? Who is the independent director? Then there used to be another argument, every independence has a price. If the price is right, independence goes for a toss. So what is that independence? Now, as I said, these are all debatable issues. Law can only provide this much. Beyond that, it is for the individual, because after all, ethics and morality cannot be legislated. Although some parameters may be provided, but an individual knows. When he or she is compromising independence, individual knows. Forget the law, even if section 149 would not be there, still each professional would know where he or she is transgressing or where one is compromising, whether it is independence or not. World may know or not know, but I would know if I am doing a wrong. So it is a question of ultimately individual, but the government or the lawmakers, because they come under flag, they have to provide certain parameters which are measurable, and therefore this is one of those measurable parameters that, believing that 3 years cooling period where no relationship with the company, particularly in the context of pecuniary relationship, is there, then that person is again eligible. But concession has been given to legal or consulting firms. They can continue to have professional relationship with the company, except for the condition that the fees an advocate or a solicitor or a law firm collects from the company should not exceed 10% of the total revenue of that particular firm or revenue of that particular consultant or that individual. Because perhaps more than 10% dependence on one firm may lead to compromise, because that particular professional or that firm of professionals may be more dependent. But no such concession has been given so far as the auditors are concerned of all the three categories, whether it is company secretaries or chartered accountants or cost auditors. There is no room, because perhaps the auditors are at a more exalted position, and therefore there is no room for concession, whereas legal and consulting firms have been given that leeway. So here the government has believed that there is some room, whereas the auditor, you have to have total cut out from the company and no personal benefit. Then the person holds together with his relatives 2% or more of the total voting power of the company. Now this is something akin to used to be there under section 299, that the threshold was 2%, then otherwise you are treated as an interested person. But somehow, although in most of the cases, holder of 2% may not really make any difference, because either if the management is having clear majority, it doesn't bother. But in certain given situations, it could make a difference, particularly in the context of special resolution. And if the management has marginal majority, then even 2% perhaps could make a difference. So holding out 2%, such a person again cannot be independent director. This is another new category of chief executive. He is the chief executive or director by whatever name called. Because in case of NGOs, different titles may be there, secretary general, director general, etc., etc. That receives 25% or more of its receipts from the company or any of the promoters, directors, or it's again any of the group companies, or that NGO holds 2% or more of the total voting power of the company. So a person who is chief executive in an NGO which is dependent, because 25% or more means it is dependent in a big way on a particular company, then he is also not eligible to become an independent director. Or if that particular NGO, though not receiving funds, is holding 2% or more, then again that person cannot be an independent director because of the influence he will wield through the shareholding. Now these are two added further by SEBI regulation clause 49. Whether he is a material supplier, service provider, or customer, or lessor, or lessee of the company. Now one thing we find, so far as SEBI is concerned, not only in the context of independent director, SEBI generally tries to come up with regulations where my feeling, it wants to show its presence felt. Now simple, like e-voting, which all of you would be aware, MCA announced that e-voting has been put on hold till 31st December. SEBI kept quiet and allowed others to have confusion. Although, in my personal view, there was no confusion because listed company is bound by SEBI regulations, in addition to whatever else it may be. And if SEBI is keeping quiet, automatically it is applicable. Although now it has clarified through the press that there is no change and e-voting continues. Similarly, in case of independent directors, which we will discuss when we come to the term of independent director, that SEBI had to be different from the Companies Act. Because SEBI says, I am concerned with listed companies and I do whatever is required for listed companies, I am not bothered about the Companies Act. Similarly, who is less than 21 years of age, again this is the criteria under the clause 49, not under section 149. Now in addition, the law provides, as if these all were not enough, possess such other qualifications as may be prescribed. So when this was first announced before the rules, everybody was wondering, first of all, where are we going to locate such independent directors who will be meeting all this? Because somebody will turn out to be a relative of somebody, somebody will turn out to be connected with some company, somebody will be a supplier to some company, somebody will be a buyer of some company, and now they possess such other qualifications as may be prescribed. Now what is prescribed? An independent director shall possess appropriate skills, experience and knowledge in one or more fields of finance, law, management, sales, marketing, administration, research, corporate governance, technical operations, or other disciplines related to the company's business. Of course, the intention is good. Intention is that each board that requires an independent director should have people from different fields who can then contribute. And here let me share my personal experience with you. I find that there are some very intelligent promoters who otherwise they may end up paying huge professional fees to professionals. They catch hold of them and request them to join the board, and then through the year